This is the BBC.
This podcast is supported by advertising outside the UK.
BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.
Hello and welcome to Only Artists from BBC Radio 4. No milk, two creative sugars. I'm Cathy Clugston, here to introduce the artists and then leave them to it.
Hello, I'm Tom Hiddleston and I'm an actor. And I've asked to speak to Nicholas Britell, the composer, who I've heard began his musical journey after seeing Chariots of Fire as a child. And Chariots of Fire also inspired me in lots of ways. My love of film and my love of running. That's the beginning of a conversation about the things we love.
The actor Tom Hiddleston talks to the composer Nicholas Britell.
Hey!
Thank you for inviting me to speak with you.
Tom Hiddleston's screen credits include The Night Manager on television and the Thor and Avengers films in the cinema. On stage, he has played Coriolanus to great acclaim and is currently starring in Betrayal by Harold Pinter.
Music to my ears, literally.
Nicholas Britell received Academy Award nominations for his scores for the films If Beale Street Could Talk and Moonlight. He also wrote the music for Vice, the recent film about Dick Cheney.
I have heard that Chariots of Fire was the reason that you started playing the piano. It was also a big inspiration to me. And having watched that film, I went over to the piano and tried to play it. And my piano playing began and ended there. But it did give me a lifelong love of running. But it seems it gave you a lifelong love of composition, and I just wanted to ask you about that moment.
Chariots of Fire was so impactful for me, and I love finding a kindred spirit who loved Chariots of Fire as well. You know, it's one of those interesting things where when we're very young, there are these moments that we can't explain why certain things affect us in the ways that they do. And yeah. I was about 5 years old, I guess, and I saw Chariots of Fire. I became completely obsessed. There was something about that amazing score by Vangelis and that famous theme, and it was exhilarating and inspiring. And we had this old upright piano in our apartment on West End Avenue, and I tried to figure out how to play it. And somehow, for some reason, I asked my mom for piano lessons, like right there. I was like, I want to know, like, how do you do this? And from there, I just became passionately obsessed with the piano and thought about being a concert pianist. And over time, that evolved really more into a focus on composition. You know, and since then, I've spent a lot of time actually wondering about that experience as well, because I think there is something really special about the interaction of the music and the movie. Mm. It's a period film, you know, it's set in the early 20th century about these runners and the lead up to the 1924 Olympics. Mm. But, you know, it's not the type of thing where they said, oh, the movie's set in the early 20th century, so let's figure out the sound of music in 1918 and that'll be the score.
You know?
I think what's so amazing about it is that actually it's a 1980s synthesizer score. And yet there's no moment when you're watching that movie where that doesn't feel perfectly linked with the film and with the world. It's not really an intellectual experience, it's an emotional experience. And I think all of these experiences are about finding these feelings. There's this sort of almost mystical element, I think, to some of these creations where we don't ourselves fully understand what's happening. That's why it's so fascinating.
I feel the same, you know, and I think my lifelong private passion has been film music. This is a strange admission, but I remember being disappointed when I went to the cinema as a child that reality didn't have a soundtrack because it was so exciting. I can't ride horses without thinking of John Williams' score from Indiana Jones. I just want to sort of immediately have it start playing.
Oh, wow.
And as a teenager, I would go to record shops in London and in Oxford where I lived, and I would specifically spend hours in the soundtrack section. So I really wanted to find the music from the films I loved. But when I started working on set or on stage, I realized that they don't necessarily have the score. So you're having to find the emotional truth of the moment without the music in a way creating a tone. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
It must be so interesting for you if you see a rough cut or an assembly of a film before you've begun to score it. For example, let's say Barry Jenkins, with whom you worked on Moonlight and If Beale Street Could Talk. Do you go away and begin to work on some music based on the screenplay and your conversations? Or do you wait to see an edit and then go, I know exactly what this needs?
I think it's a very personal choice on the part of composers on how they approach that. I know some composers who don't want to be affected in any way by anything until they see an early cut or footage. You know, they want to only kind of respond to the movie as the movie. I'm kind of the opposite of that, where I feel that there is something really special about reading a screenplay, even having a conversation with the director before they've shot their film, because I think that, A, you have more time, which is amazing, as we know, and you have more time, you can, you know, kind of explore more ideas. So, for example, like working with Barry on Moonlight, I had read the script before Barry shot the film, and my first feeling after reading Moonlight, which, you know, for me was the most beautiful script I'd ever read, I just thought it was a work of poetry. It was so stunning, and that initial feeling, that feeling that this is actually a poem, it was so tender and so intimate and so powerful. The first thought I had was, what would the musical analog of that feeling be? Like, what would a piece of music be if it were a poem? And so I actually wrote a piece for piano and violin.
Which piece was that?
So that's this piece that ended up being Little's theme in the movie.
Ah, yes. Yeah,
and it's beautiful. I called that piece initially, the name I'd given it was Piano and Violin Poem. And so I sent it to Barry and I said, you know, here's this sort of musical poem. And he put it up against the early cut of the movie. And, you know, actually my demo recording is what's in the movie. That's sort of a long way of saying that that definitely does not always happen. There are lots of times where I'll write something and let's say I have the footage now and I'm responding to it and I'll write something and it might be too direct. You know, it might be too on the nose or the idea that I'm saying in the music might be already in the picture, you know? And sometimes I use this metaphor of, you know, you don't want to put a hat on a hat, you know? Sometimes if the
movie
already has a feeling, if you see something, you don't need to also hear it. You don't even always know intellectually why it works.
No.
And you feel it. That may sound very vague and unhelpful, but it's almost...
It doesn't. I'm obsessed.
You know what I mean?
I'm obsessed with that.
Yeah.
With trying to understand why it works.
Exactly. It's like a physical thing, actually. Like a little bit of a chill down your spine. Or the thing I love maybe more than anything is where you write a piece and you put it up against the picture and all of a sudden you see the scene... And you feel the scene completely differently.
Yes.
It feels like it like unlocks something that was latent within the film, but now it's unlocked and you see even more.
There's a deeper dimension to what's going on.
Exactly. And we don't often know, I think, sometimes why or how that's happening. I think no matter how many years or decades you get the opportunity to do this, you still never really know.
No. Because as human beings, we don't often say what we mean. Sometimes we do, but not always. And so sometimes the truth of a scene is actually the subtext.
Mm.
And if the characters are not telling the truth to each other, the music can actually express the truth as a counterpoint to the dialogue.
Yes.
Which fills out the frame in some way.
Absolutely. And often stage plays don't have music. Let's say there is that double meaning that's happening where there are words and then there's a subtext that you're actually sort of trying to express. How conscious are you moment to moment on stage of trying to transmit that other feeling, even though your words have to say the more overt meaning?
Yes, it's really curious you ask that because sometimes my preparation to go on stage, a huge part of it is listening to music. Because it's such a quick evocation of emotion and tone. Because music is so vital and it creates such a physical response, I think if I can carry that somehow in myself, in my body, as I walk on stage, that the words will come out in the right shape. so that the music is a diving board that gets me into the water in some way. There's a memory I have. I was in a production of Othello in 2007 at the Donmar Warehouse in London, directed by Michael Grandage, with Chiwetel Ejiofor as Othello, Ewan McGregor as Iago, Michelle Fairley as Amelia, Kelly Riley as Desdemona. They were absolutely extraordinary as the central quartet. And I was playing Michael Cassio, who is Othello's lieutenant. And his first appearance is in the second scene of the play. He basically has been up all night running around Venice looking for Othello, who's disappeared. His boss has completely disappeared, and he's being called and summoned to the central council of the city. And Cassio is driven to distraction trying to find Othello. He comes in and he says to Othello, "The Duke does greet you, General, and he requires your haste post-haste appearance even on the instant." And Othello says, "What is the matter, think you?" And Cassio says, "Something from Cyprus, as I may divine, it is a business of some heat." And this great import of the thing he's about to deliver. And at the Donmar Warehouse in Covent Garden, there's a fire escape between the dressing rooms. And in the middle of the first scene, I would have my headphones in and I would run up and down the stairs of the fire escape with my broadsword on my left
hip.
Listening to the Trevor Jones score from Last of the Mohicans.
Oh, wow.
Specifically, the first track, which is The Elk Hunt. If you remember that film, it's Daniel Day-Lewis at the beginning of the film, like, herring through the forest.
Yeah.
And it's got this extraordinary propulsive momentum, this urgency, and there's a sort of emotion of running. And running up and down the fire escape at the Donmar and listening to this track felt like a key into the romance of the play, the profundity of the subject matter, the kind of ancient quality of this piece.
Mm.
And I walked on stage trying to carry all of those things within me. But it's precisely because when I saw The Last of the Mohicans when I was 12, it left a lasting impact. And I know it was something to do with the romance of the story, the performances of Daniel Day-Lewis and Madeleine Stowe and Wes Studi, and that score.
Yeah. Well, there's
I don't
so
know if
much
it answers your question.
That. No, that totally does. And actually, I love the idea that in a way, what you're doing in those moments that you're talking about with Othello, you're almost scoring the performance before the performance, you know?
Well, I'm trying to give myself a way in. It's a way into a particular...
You're doing kind of what I would be doing after seeing the performance in a way, or imagining
yeah.
it. Because I guess this is one of the interesting things with the whole process is that there's a choice that you have to make of what is that feeling.
Yes.
There are so many scores that are possible, and I think that's the thing that's sort of daunting. What is the right sound?
Here's a question. Do you instinctively know what instrument you want to use?
Mm.
I get so fascinated when I listen to a score and to many of your scores. I think, how did he know that it was piano and violin for Little Steam? How did he know it was... Is it an oboe in Agape, in If Beale Street Could Talk?
That's actually multiple upper brass instruments. So there's almost like a choir of flutes.
Oh, a choir of flutes. You see, I was trying to work out what it was because it's got so much hope in it.
But the notes that are doing the upper movement, which actually there are some arpeggios and there are some really, really virtuosic brass playing up there. It's a combination of trumpet and flugelhorn, and actually the very upper notes are piccolo trumpets that can play really, really high.
Wow.
And playing very softly.
I was trying to work it out.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah, that's what that is. That question of what are the right instruments is a very deep one. It's such a strange thing, but for example, some movies you play a piano against it or a violin note and it just feels like it's in that world right away. It just feels like
yes.
it's part of the movie.
Yeah.
And then in the same film, you play a clarinet note, just one note. And you're like, wow, that's not this movie at all. It just doesn't weave in some way. And I don't know why that is.
Agape sets up that film, If Beale Street Could Talk. It sets up the tone of the entire piece. It's so moving. And you realize that this is a film about love.
The initial ideas that I had for Beale Street, Barry had first said to me, this was before he shot the film, that he was imagining the sound of brass and horns. And so I went off and I started experimenting with trumpets and flugelhorns and French horns and cornet. And as music, he really loved it. But when we put it up against the picture, it just felt like it wasn't quite right. And it was almost too direct, some of my first ideas. And what we discovered was that it was missing this sound of cellos. And in particular, this feeling of cellos was what became that feeling of love. There's romantic love, there's erotic love, there's the love that parents have for their children. And then we named these different pieces actually after those ancient Greek words for love. So for example, the agape track, that for us was trying to represent this almost kind of unconditional divine love. In Moonlight, this sort of very quiet piano where, you know, when I'm playing it, I'm holding the soft pedal down so that the hammers move over a little bit, so they're actually playing fewer of the strings and you're getting a softer sound. That's that left pedal on the piano. I had Tim Fain, who's the incredible violinist, record the violin really, really close to the microphone. I said to him, actually, can you play as quietly as you possibly can while still having sound, you know? So still feel confident in the sound, but play as quietly as you can. And so what you're hearing is that combination of sounds where both instruments are actually playing very quietly and very intimately. And then in my mix, when I put them together, you know, I was able to sort of boost the sound up a little bit. So you hear everything, and you hear the bow sound, and you hear, actually, I left in even the sound of Tim breathing.
Yeah. It's like a close-up. It's like a film close-up.
Totally like a film close-up.
As an actor, you feel like when you're really in close-up that actually the truth of what's going on can be expressed so quietly. Any louder and it's just going to jar. For different characters or for different moments in different films, I feel myself trying to find, you know, I need my violin for this bit, or I need the trumpet for this bit. Using aspects of oneself to illuminate something about character.
Yeah.
But without an orchestra of instruments at my fingertips.
Right.
So as Loki, for example, it was always about how do I best express this mischief and vulnerability at the same time. There's a scene in the first Thor film where Loki finds out that he's been adopted for the first time.
Yeah.
And it's just a two-hander with myself and Sir Anthony Hopkins. But it was quite a vulnerable scene. And Patrick Doyle scored the picture beautifully. And every time Loki is on screen, it's all minor. It sounds duplicitous somehow. Even his raw vulnerability sounds like it has a side to it.
Yeah.
Which contrasts with the redemptive major key of Thor's theme. It's so fascinating how the music becomes the prism through which the emotional light is shone.
Totally.
There was a piece, actually, I used to listen to called Mind Heist by Zach Kempsey. I don't know if you've ever come across it.
I don't know.
It has a kind of ticking clock momentum, which always reminded me of the speed of his mind.
Oh, wow.
An extraordinary kind of grandiose brass and percussion, which it just feels immediately epic. Those films, quite often, my physical experience is that I am in a studio surrounded by green screen.
Right.
And in an airless room, you know, in full costume.
Yeah.
It's a Friday afternoon. The crew are rather looking forward to finishing for the week. And actually, the thing I have to do is create within myself high stakes. Like, the universe is going to fall apart if Loki doesn't do this thing. Or he's going to betray his brother or die for the nth time.
Right.
And within myself, try to create that between action and cut.
Do you really start to almost sort of inhabit that world outside of your work in a way? Because these ideas must, you know, they're imprinting so closely on you.
Yeah, it's interesting. On stage, you're always protected by the integrity of the piece as a whole. At the same time, at 7:30 every night, the curtain goes up and no one's going to call cut and you can't do it again. The bonus of doing a play is that because you're living through the journey of the character without stopping, you carry the emotional momentum. I'll never forget, I was lucky enough to play Hamlet 2 years ago, directed by Kenneth Branagh at my old drama school. And after the first 4 days of rehearsals, Kenneth Branagh decided to do a first run-through of the entire play. And it was my first experience of the extraordinary, intricate labyrinth of emotion that Shakespeare has constructed for that actor. I used to say it was like downhill skiing on a black diamond. The hairpin turns you're having to make emotionally. Yeah. He goes from grief to wit to terror to loss to almost a kind of hysteria. Mm-hmm. And this endorphin rush of adrenaline and love and friendship and filial rage, but it's never just one thing. What they used to do in Wittenberg was they all went dancing together. And then he says, I have of late, but wherefore I know not, lost all my mirth. And he's expressing the most heartrending and lyrical expression of what it means to be depressed that's possibly ever been committed in the English language. Kenneth Branagh has played the part many, many times. And he said, just so you know, you will feel mad. This will feel like a mad experience because it's so raw. But the pleasure of doing the whole thing is that you carry with you the emotion from the previous scene. Mm-hmm. And that's the biggest difference between film and theatre, I think, is that in film you're working forensically in isolation on that one moment and you work on it for 4 hours and then you've got it in the can. But for you, it must be the same. I know you've played live and you play your scores live, mm-hmm. but also if you're working on score, it must be the similar thing where you're working on isolated moments.
It's such a great point. One of the biggest challenges in working in film is this sort of micro level exploration of a scene or even of just like part of a scene or of a moment. And yet the architecture of the whole, the macro, the experience of being in the audience and watching a movie, that's actually what you're going for. So there's this sort of crazy, almost mismatch between the moment-to-moment experience and work that you're doing and the actual resulting experience you're trying to create. When you are sitting amongst a group of people, you immediately, sort of almost like an animal instinct kind of a way, you just feel when things are working and when they're not. And it's happened to me that some of my favorite moments or the moments I think are working maybe best, I will go and see it with a group before we've released the film, you know, while we're still in process of working on it. And I'll realize that it was totally not working, actually, in context of the movie.
Right.
And you have to be always ready to say, all right, let's get rid of that. That did not work, you know? And it's a very...
I won't ask you which one. You don't have to
It's okay. No, it happens all the time. It's not too many to name.
Well, the same, you know, you do a version of a scene in rehearsal, you'd be like, I'm terribly sorry, that was not right. I'll never do it again. I apologize to everyone who was present to witness that. It doesn't represent the human condition in any way. It was just really bad.
And I'll feel the same way where I'll be like, wow. And actually, I think it's because a scene just cut out from a movie on its own has its own feeling and out of context with little dialogue and just score could almost seem like a music video.
Yeah. I know how much of an influence hip hop has been on you as well. Talk about that for a bit, because I'm fascinated by that.
It just completely changed the way that I thought about music. And when I was in college, some very dear friends of mine and I started a hip-hop band. I was writing beats and writing tracks like all day long, every day. And I got into this rhythm with writing music where I think when I was growing up with classical music, sometimes I wondered, you know, what does it mean to be a composer? And it's impossible to imagine being like a Mozart. So how can I even attempt to write music, you know, if there are these, you know, almost like godlike figures, you know? And one of the things that I loved about...
Well, at this point, we're all just remixing. We're all sampling and remixing.
We're all just like doing our humble...
It's all been done. It's all been done.
It's also very exciting. What do we do? And I think that it was that daily habit of writing where actually I loved writing music. And... Mm. that was where I realized, well, if I write music every day, maybe I am a composer.
Oh, you are. Let me tell you, you are. But on hip hop, Succession, mm-hmm. the series about this media mogul and his family. The way you play the piano in that opening theme, there's a drama to it and an energy to it. I think that is a hip-hop track. Do you agree?
I think so as well. You know, it's this purposely out-of-tune, absurd classical piano on top. I'm definitely trying to provide a energy and a gravitas as well, which I think represents the Roy family, and also yes. is a bit meta in the way that I'm not necessarily saying this is who they are. I'm also kind of saying this is who they think they are. You know?
Uh-huh,
so
nice.
These yeah. ideas of power and of who and what is in control of our lives, you know, many of the important issues of our day. And yet at the same time, there is a necessary and clear absurdity in the way in which some of these people go about their lives.
That, there's almost hubris in it. There's
absolutely,
a kind of hubris in it.
Absolutely. Like, how do we play that? And the way that I approached that was by doubling down on the gravitas, actually. If there's something that is funny or absurd, it wasn't by lightening it up and I'm going to have the music go closer to that. It was actually by saying, no, I'm going to go even more serious and even more dark. And that, to me, is actually funnier, darker, and more absurd. Sometimes the most powerful musical statements you can make in a film or a television series are actually with the fewest notes. I think sometimes we associate size and grandeur with more. And I often find it's the opposite, where more is actually one piano note that can feel like the biggest, most potent statement of something. And ironically, sometimes 100 instruments playing at once in a big sound can sometimes make things feel kind of small in a weird way, where it's almost like taking up too much space, or it's almost saying too much. And sometimes saying a lot less feels more like that existential questioning.
Well, that's the power of film music. I mean, you could be swimming in the sea, swimming in the ocean, and somebody could be playing Claire de Lune, and you'd have the most magical experience. You think, I'm being bathed in, all of your worries fall away because Claire de Lune is playing. But if somebody starts playing Jaws, you just want to get out of there.
Immediately. You should leave the water.
You're like, well, you've ruined it now. That's it. I hate being in the ocean. And then now it's all over. I can see a horror poem in your future.
We shall see. I'll keep you posted.
Only artists need more inspiration? Just go to BBC Sounds.